to sing in the valley, to look toward your goodness.
Yes.
My heart's set on who you are. You're the light that consumes the dark. The joy and the strength to lift up my
heaven's door.
Thank you. Just lift your hands. Oh God, we call upon you now, for you are most holy, Lord. And all the angels bow. All the elders bow down and lay their crowns at your feet, Lord. And we come today, Lord, as your children, to worship you, to honor you, to praise you, to love you, Lord. And we lift our hands in praise and exaltation now.
Holy, holy,
Holy God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Church, as Jesus rode down the road on the Mount of Olives, the Pharisees said, why do they sing and shout? Why do you let them sing and shout? And he said, because if they don't, the stones will. The rocks will cry out my praise. And I just want you to know it's a good time. It's a good time in America. It's a good time in the world for the church not to let the stones cry out. Don't let them cry out in our place, church. This morning, let's raise our hands and shout and sing and praise the holy God. Let's look at the Savior as he passes through this room. See his scars, see his stripes, and praise the holy God. Jesus, we come before you this morning, God, and you are holy. You are holy. You are perfect. You are clean. And you make us clean, Jesus. We thank you for your blood, God. We thank you for your stripes. We thank you for your goodness that just continues to overflow in us, God, in your presence. We thank you for your Holy Spirit, that he knows us individually, that he sees our flaws, that he loves us anyways. God, we're just so thankful for your presence this morning. So grateful that you show up, that you're faithful to be here time and time again. And God, I just declare that as the church, we're not going to let the rocks cry out in our place. We're going to be a church of worship. We're going to be a church who does not let your worship and praise fall off of our tongue, God. You are a good God, and you are worthy this morning. We love you. We praise you, Jesus. In your holy, precious, and mighty name, the church said, amen. Amen. You can be seated. Good morning. Hallelujah. I got one more word, church, before we really kick in. God gave me this just a couple months back, and it stayed with me, and I want to share it with you before we really kick off. God spoke to me about Luke 5, and in that passage, it talks about Jesus was teaching and educating everybody, and the crowds were gathered around him. And some people, they grabbed up a paralyzed man. I assume it was probably their friend. He's laying on a mat and he's paralyzed. And they pick him up and they bring him to Jesus. And they can't get in because the crowd was so heavy. It was so tight, they couldn't get through the doorway. And here they are packing this paralyzed man. So they decide to climb up on the roof. And they start tearing off tile. And they dig a hole so they can get to Jesus. They dug a hole so they can get this man who needed a Savior to Jesus. And I just want to let you know, it's been on my heart. And maybe it's for our church as well. It's a good time to get desperate for our friends. It's a really good time to get desperate for the people in our communities. And to pick them up. To grab them up with us and keep them with us and bring them to church. Get them online. Do whatever it takes to get them in the presence of a holy God and a mighty Savior. Amen. I just want to welcome everybody. Everybody online, welcome. Thank you for joining us. Everybody here in person. It's such a blessing to be here on a Sunday morning. I love being in the house of God. And just so grateful to see everybody here this morning. If you are new, you should receive the Connect card. Right there, it should look something like that. If you will fill that out and return it to the front desk here in the foyer, you will receive a gift on your way out. If you did not get one of those, you can raise your hand, find somebody that has one or that can get you one, or you can get one on the way out and fill it out there as well. I got some announcements this morning. As always, you can give. I got a scripture on my phone this morning. It's the daily scripture from the Bible app. The generous will prosper. Those who refresh others will themselves be refreshed. Proverbs 11:25. We've got several ways to give, mailing, online, and texting. And it's all there, right there. You can see it. But I just want you guys to know that personally, and you can ask anybody in this church, tithing is so big. It's such a big part of your walk. Jesus said we ought to tithe. You know, a lot of people say that's Old Testament, but Jesus said it. And if Jesus said it, I'm going to follow it. And I believe that we're blessed to be a blessing. I believe that God provides for us so we can help those who need it. So again, there's several ways to give. get my notes out here. As always, this is Christ Tabernacle. You know, we are here to help you know God, find freedom, discover your purpose, and ultimately make a difference. Right now, we're just a church after God. We don't know what tomorrow brings. We don't know what next week brings. But we're just chasing Jesus. That's all we can do right now. And so just hope you guys will join along with us. Speaking of not knowing what's going to happen tomorrow or next week, this Wednesday we plan on having a picnic. I think it's going to get rained out, so that has been canceled. I'm going to start talking to the pastor or something about this. This is really starting to bother me. I'm getting hungry, and I look forward to eating with you guys. But we are going to have a night of prayer and worship, and to me, that's just as good as eating any night. And I believe that the presence of God always shows up, and He will really bless you this Wednesday night. So be here at 6:30. Tonight we have Growth Track. If you were here for Discover membership, you can show up to this. Or this is just a continuation of discovering what we're about, and ultimately discovering who you're about. And you'll kind of learn some more about yourself and your spiritual gifts. And it's a great place to be tonight from 5:30 to 7:30. I believe there will be food, so you can eat there. Nightly prayer from 6 to 7 every day. Brian Wright has been such a blessing to me. He's such a godly man, and he really moves in the gifts of God. And I believe that God has really laid this on his heart. And I believe, like I said, it's just a good time for the church to stand up and be the church. And that includes praying. It includes worshiping. And any night you're free, I have yet to be able to attend, but I look forward to doing so. That's a great place to be from 6 to 7 any night. And then lastly, our youth on Wednesday is still meeting. So if you know any young people, that's also the place to be. We want to see our kids saved. We want to see them back in church as well. As Brandon said last Sunday, we're doing all the precautions. We're wearing the mask and doing the social distancing as best as we can. So thank you guys for being here. We love you all, and we're looking forward to a great word. If you'll just join me in prayer this morning. Father God, we just come before you. And again, God, we just love you. We thank you for your presence this morning. And we just believe and know that you have something in store for each and every one of us, God. You see us as individuals. You see our individual situations. You see our needs and our desires. And I just pray that this morning all thoughts and all concerns fall away just for a few moments, God, so we can be completely in tune with you and what you desire for us, God. We love you. We praise you in this place. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, come on, let's give the Lord one more hand clap of praise. Amen. So good to see all of you here today. You know, he announced that the picnic was canceled. Y'all didn't even know about a picnic, did you? That's because we didn't tell you. I got so tired of canceling things. So, Bryce, you just messed me up. I mean, it was like, I'll just like, if the weather's good, we'll just announce it at the last minute. Everybody will be happy. And so we never told you about it. And then he told you about it. So anyway, but, you know, we need to pray. And so, again, I want to thank Brian and Dorinda for heading that up. And every night they have been here praying from 6 to 7. And so thankful for them. Them and a handful of others praying every night. But then come out this Wednesday for sure. Night of worship, prayer. We're going to pray for our nation. We're going to pray for those people we know who are sick and suffering. And how many of you know someone right now who's suffering from COVID? You know, that's maybe in the hospital. I just heard about another couple that I don't know, but a friend of mine said that some friends of his were suffering. And so, listen, I know it's still there. And so we want to continue to pray that God will be with those who are suffering from that and anything else. And then also the youth this Wednesday night, Brandon said to let the youth know that they're actually going to be in here with us this Wednesday. They're going to worship and pray along with this. I mean, I just love it when the youth join us for our prayer meetings because they add something to it. They know how to pray, I'm telling you. They know how to go after God, and it really takes our worship to another level when they're here. So I'm excited about that. If you would, open your Bibles this morning two passages of scripture, just open to the book of Nehemiah and to the book of Ephesians. So Nehemiah, if you're new to your Bibles, is in the Old Testament. So, you know, it's right after 1 and 2 Samuel, 1 and 2 Kings, 1 and 2 Chronicles, and then Ezra, and then Nehemiah there in the Old Testament. And then Ephesians is in the New Testament. So Galatians and then Ephesians right there in the New. And I want to bring a message this morning that I really believe is a word from the Lord. You know, sometimes the Lord just gives me a teaching or something to ground you in the faith, and then there's times that I feel like that it's a word for the church that's for the season we're in exactly right now. I always pray about what to preach on. And honestly, when I felt like he gave me this word, I was like, you know, it really doesn't make sense. Because the word that he gave me is it's time to rebuild. You know, it's time to rebuild. And generally, when you think about rebuilding, you rebuild after the storm is over, right? I mean, that makes sense. You think about 9/11. When 9/11 happened, the destruction is there, the lives are lost. And after it happened, I remember Mayor Rudy Giuliani saying, we're going to rebuild, and we're going to come back stronger. Or think about like Hurricane Katrina. What was that, 2005, I believe, and where it just wiped out New Orleans and devastated the homes. And after the hurricane passed, George Bush, President Bush at the time, he said, you know what, it's time to rebuild. We're going to rebuild. And so, you know, it's one thing after the disaster has happened to say it's time to rebuild, but it's another thing while you're still in the middle of it to say, okay, everybody, it's time to rebuild. I mean, that's like, you know, your roof is getting blown off in a hurricane and say, we need to get up there and fix that. No, you wait till the hurricane is over, and then you do it. And so when I felt like the Lord saying, Troy, it's time to rebuild, I was thinking, that does, you know, it's not over yet. And so what I want you to know is this isn't a plea for those of you who are home to come back to church. That's not what this is about. But he led me to the book of Nehemiah because Nehemiah, the situation there is that they had rebuilt most of the city. They had gone back. If you remember when we did the book of Daniel series, the children of Israel, because of their rebellion, because of their disobedience, God actually allowed another nation, the Babylonians, to come in and take them captive, take them out of Jerusalem, take them to Babylon, and then they just destroyed the city. They destroyed the temple. They destroyed the walls. They destroyed the homes. They completely just leveled the city of Jerusalem. And they took the people captive for 70 years. And then after 70 years, if you remember, by the hand of God, a remnant of the people went back to Jerusalem and they rebuilt the temple. And so, and it took them a long time. It took them 20 years to rebuild the temple because they kept getting sidetracked. And then they built their own houses. In fact, God got a little upset at them. He said, your houses look great. My house is still in ruins. And so they had to inspire them. God would send prophets and people say, come on, come on, come on, let's get it done. And they finally got it done after 20 years. But listen, the thing that they didn't do is they didn't rebuild the walls around the city. And so even though the temple was good, the people were in distress because the enemy nations around them could just come and attack them anytime they wanted because they hadn't taken the time to rebuild the walls. And what's crazy is they waited after the temple was rebuilt. I want you to think about this. It was 72 years before they ever even started rebuilding the walls. So imagine that. They're back in their hometown. They've got their temple. They've got their worship. They've got their homes. But yet, because they haven't reestablished the boundaries, because they haven't built their walls of protection, for 72 years, they were constantly being bombarded by the enemy. For a lifetime, something that could have been done, they kept putting off because there wasn't a good time. It just wasn't a good time. I mean, anytime they would start to do something, the enemy would come, and they were just like, well, whenever they leave us alone, then we'll do it. Right? Whenever that enemy will just stop attacking us, and then whenever we get a break, then we'll rebuild. But yet, how many know the enemy is not going to stop attacking? And what was true in the natural is true in the spiritual. Let's look at Nehemiah chapter 1. And I'm not going to do a verse by verse. I'm just going to hit some high points. And not just today, but in the weeks to come, we're going to get a strategy for how to rebuild, how to fight spiritual battles, how to reestablish some things in our life that we have allowed maybe to be broken down. Because COVID and some things that even before then, we blame it on COVID now, but there was some stuff we were dealing with that we just have never dealt with that we need to deal with. And it's time to rebuild. And so Nehemiah 1, let's look at this verse 1. It says, the words of Nehemiah, the son of Hakaliah, it came to pass in the month of Chislev, in the 20th year as I was in Shushan in the citadel, that Hanani, one of my brethren, came with men from Judah. And I asked them concerning the Jews who had escaped, who had survived the captivity concerning Jerusalem. And they said to me, the survivors who are left from the captivity in the province are there in great distress and reproach. And the wall of Jerusalem is also broken down, and its gates are burned with fire. And so it was when I heard these words that I sat down and wept and mourned, look at this, for many days. And I was fasting and praying before the God of heaven. See, Nehemiah wasn't a preacher. He wasn't a prophet. And in fact, his job is he was working in, and it says he was in Susa. That was the kingdom at that time, just like the Babylonians had their time. Here he is in the kingdom. And in his people, he was a Jew, but yet he wasn't living in Jerusalem. They were hundreds and hundreds of miles away, and there were no airplanes, right? They're forever away. And so for someone to come back, here he is serving, and he was actually serving as the cupbearer to the king. You say, well, what's that about? Well, one of the things that they would do is if you wanted to take out the king, the common way of taking out the king in those days is they would poison his food. If they didn't like him, they'd say, well, let's put a little poison in his drink. Let's put poison in his food. And so for the king, before he would take a drink, he'd say, Nehemiah. And Nehemiah would come over and he'd say, all right, here we go. You know, and he would take a drink. If he didn't die, the king was like, it's all good. Imagine anybody want to sign up for that job. I mean, it has some benefits. You get to live in the palace. You got access to the king. But how many of you know that just means you're really expendable, right? It means like the king, he's like, he likes you. He trusts you, but not that much. I mean, if you die, I like you, but better you than me. And that was a position he had. It wasn't really a position of authority. In fact, he probably saw himself pretty small. Like, I'm expendable. You know, it doesn't matter. You know, they don't care if I die. But yet, he had this heart, even though he's serving in one country, he is longing. He just loves his home country of Jerusalem. And so when some guys show up, it says when my brothers showed up, some other Jews come, he's so excited because, listen, there was no TV, there was no internet, there was no cell phones, there was no post office, there wasn't even the Pony Express. And so, listen, here they had traveled, and he's just assuming, my goodness, they went back to Jerusalem 70 years ago. They've been there for a lifetime. I can just imagine that things are thriving in Jerusalem. I'm sure the temple is just kicking. Worship is awesome. The nation is reestablished. But yet when his brothers came back, he said, so how's it going? And they said, it's terrible. He said, the people are in distress. The wall, and notice this, or verse 3, the people are in great distress and reproach. In other words, the people are a disgrace. It's a disgrace if you saw what was going on. He said, the walls are broken down and the gates are burned with fire. Here's what I want you to know. Listen, the temple was in good shape, but the people were in distress. And I really feel like, you know, when you look at COVID-19 and what's happened, I mean, who could have imagined this started, what, March 15th? Here we are, mid-October, 6 months later, still going on. If you'd have told me that at the beginning of the year, we'd still be in the middle of this, and in some places having higher numbers than they had in the beginning. If you'd have told me that, I'd be like, nah. If you'd have told me that there were still some churches in the country that still haven't opened, I'd have been like, nah, I can't imagine it. I don't believe it. And but listen, here's the thing. Can I just, for Christ's Tabernacle, this is for us. Listen, the building's good. The church is fine. In fact, we improved things through COVID. You know, online is good. We improved in that area. We've made improvements to the building. Listen, our bank account is okay. It's, you know, giving's not what it used to be, but we're okay. The church is okay. But listen, but I'm worried about the people. Because what I see is that the people are in distress. And it seems like the enemy is just having his way with the people. It seems like the walls of protection that we have had, that we had in our life, the things that we had established, the boundaries and the things that we lived in, the disciplines, the things that we had in our lives that we knew that kept us walking in victory, that those have been broken down. And now it seems like the enemy is just attacking almost at will, and where it seems like now within the church that fear is at an all-time high and faith is at an all-time low. And I'm concerned about the state of the people. And I really want, you know, and what I feel like is that the people are kind of saying, many Christians are saying, well, you know, thinking kind of like if it was Hurricane Katrina, well, when this is all over, we'll rebuild. You know, don't talk to me about rebuilding now, Pastor. You know, when this is over, then we'll get back to normal. And again, I'm not talking about coming back to church, even though, you know, I'm excited for that day. In fact, I think it's important. I don't care if you have to wear a hazmat suit. You know, I think it's worth it. Right? Mask, gloves, put on the whole suit. I don't care. I mean, I think it's, there's just something about being in the house that is helping to reestablish the boundaries. But it's not even that. It's just like in our own lives, there's some things that I believe that the walls have been broken down. And so think about this, a lifetime that they dealt with this. And so Nehemiah, when he hears, he prays, and then in chapter 2, he actually, 4 months later, he's been praying about this for 4 months. And finally, he's there before the king one day, and he's sad, and the king knows him. He's normally a happy guy. He's normally the guy who brightens up the room and just, you know, just that guy. And this day, you know, he looks sad, and the king looks at him. He says, "Why is your face so sad? Are you sick?" He's like, "No, I'm not sick. It's a sorrow of heart." And he said, in verse 3, he's scared. He's like, "Man, if the king doesn't like me, if he thinks I'm not doing my job well, he'll just take me out." But he begins to, notice it says, verse 2, he says, he was dreadfully afraid. It was like, I'm going to bring up something. I'm going to ask the king for something big. I've been praying about this for months. And he said to the king, "May the king live forever. Why should my face not be sad when the city, the place of my father's tombs, lies in waste and its gates are burned with fire?" And the king said to me, "What do you request?" So I prayed to the God of heaven. Listen, he'd been praying for 4 months. But how many of you know, it's great that you prayed this morning, but all throughout the day, listen, when you face a tough situation, maybe you're at work and you're about to deal with that person, that you know every time you deal with them, they just know how to turn your buttons or push your buttons or whatever, and you just know, you see them coming, and it's like, that's a good time to throw up an arrow prayer. Just, "Oh, help me, Jesus, right now. Oh, God. God, you know this person. You made them. I don't even know why you did. But Lord, would you just help me?" Right? And that's a good time for an arrow prayer. Just like, "Oh, Jesus, you know me and you know them. Help me right now." And so he sent up this prayer to the Lord. And he said, "Here's what I'm asking." Notice this, verse 5. "And I said to the king, 'If it pleases the king, and if your servant has found favor in your sight,'" notice these words, "'I ask that you send me.'" Little old nothing. He's never run anything. He's never been a governor. He's not a contractor. He's not a builder. He's a cup drinker. You looked at his resume, "I drink wine. That's it. And I haven't died yet." I mean, that's it. And he says, "I'm asking that you send me to the city of my father's tombs," notice this, "that I may rebuild it." Listen, here's the first thing. If you're taking notes, I want you to write this down. If you're not taking notes, I want you to write this down. All right? pull your phone out, put this in your notes or something. Listen, if you're going to rebuild, you have to take responsibility for your own improvement. Listen, if you're really going to rebuild, if you're really going to live in victory above the enemy and the attacks of the enemy, you've got to take responsibility for yourself. In fact, Nehemiah, he took responsibility for the whole nation. He said, send me. He wasn't, you know, I'm sure for 4 months he was probably like, God, send somebody. And then God was just like, it's you, brother. It's you, my man. It's you. And listen, I'm just saying, I know we all have a past. We all have something. In fact, I had a great childhood. I didn't have many excuses. I just messed up, right? I had great parents. I was raised in church, and I still screwed up, right? Some of y'all didn't have the same things I did, and you had terrible parents, and you had a terrible upbringing. And listen, and that's been a good excuse for you. But listen, at some point, come on, you got to take responsibility for your own growth. Listen, parents, I know there's not prayer in schools, and I know they're teaching kids things that aren't that, but listen, parents, you got to take responsibility for your own kids. You've got to teach them up in the way of the Lord. Listen, I'm thankful for Pastor Brandon and Coley out there teaching kids and all that, but listen, it's your responsibility. We're here to facilitate you, but you can't just like, we get them 1 hour a week. You can't just bring off your kids and say, do something with them. Like, no, you got them all week long. We've got them one day. Can I get a witness? But it's all, every one of us have to take responsibilities for ourselves. And we have to say, you know what? I'm tired of living this way. I'm going to rise up and build with the help of my God. I'm going to rise up from these ashes and I'm going to rebuild. I'm sick and tired of the enemy having his way in my life. And you got to get sick and tired of being sick and tired to the place where you say, enough is enough. I'm going to rebuild. And I know COVID isn't over, but you know what? I'm tired of the enemy having his way in my life. And it's fear, you have to go. I'm not going to live in fear anymore. And I'm believing that faith is going to arise. And know what? What's amazing is his courage to rebuild inspired others. It inspired the king, and the king said, go for it. He said, I'm going to need money. I don't have any money. I've been working for you. You know, I'm going to need money. How much do you need? He told him how much money he needed. He said, how long are you going to be gone? He told him how long he's going to be gone. And so the king gives him all these resources and he goes. And then he has to go back to Jerusalem where these people have been living this way for 72 years. Imagine that. And here he is, an outsider. He comes and he looks at the mess. And you know what? As much as they hated it, they were comfortable with it. You know, you can live a certain way so long that you just make peace with it. Well, that's just who I am. That's just the way things are. You know, generation after generation after generation, you know, with alcoholism or living off the system, right? Welfare generation, mom, welfare generation, daughter, welfare generation, grandkids. I mean, it's just, you know, at some point you say, you know what, enough is enough. I'm going to take responsibility for myself, for my family. And just because my parents live that way, you know, listen, I'm a new creation in Christ. I have a new bloodline now. And listen, I'm going to do it. And Nehemiah shows up and he, with this courage, notice chapter 2, verse 17, he says to them, they don't know him from a jar of Skippy peanut butter. He just showed up, right? But he's like, hey, listen, the king sent me. God's hand is upon me. And he speaks to them, and they had been used to it for so long, it was their normal. And he looks at this and he says, look at the distress that we're in. Look at how God's city lies in waste, and its gates are burned with fire. Notice these words. Now come, let us build the wall of Jerusalem that we may no longer be a reproach. Come on, guys, we're a disgrace. Let's do something about it. And I told them of the hand of my God, which had been good upon me, and also the king's words that he had spoken to me. So they said, look at this, let us rise up and build. And they set their hands to this good work. Notice they took responsibility. They said, come on, let us do it. They didn't say, yeah, that's a good idea. Why don't you bring somebody else in here? No, they said, let us do it. In fact, what I love about this is he encouraged every family. He said, I want every one of you to rebuild the wall that's in front of your house. If you look out your door and that wall is broken down, that's your part to do. You know how they took a job and that they had let go for 72 years? They completed the job in 52 days. What they hadn't done in 72 years, they did in 7.5 weeks. Because every person took the responsibility for the boundary that was in front of their own house. Look at what it says in Nehemiah 3:10. It says, adjoining this, Jedidiah, the son of Haramath, made repairs opposite his house. And Hattush, son of, your guess is as good as mine, made repairs next to him. Listen, every person said that's my responsibility. And listen, every parent has to take responsibility. Every dad has to say, you know what? As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. As for us, listen, devil, you're not going to have any more access to my family. You know, we're going to take a stand. We're going to rebuild the walls in front of our house. And as they all began to rebuild the wall in front of their house, they did an amazing work. But listen, the people were all in. And I just want you to know, if you're going to really rebuild and walk in victory, I'm tired of seeing Christians live defeated lives. I want you to walk in victory. I really do. But if you're going to rebuild and walk in victory, listen, you have to be all in. You the only way it works, listen, I have been in church my whole life. I haven't always served Jesus, but I've been in church my whole life. And can I just tell you this? I have seen people walk in victory, and I have seen people that were in church for decades and never grew. They were the same, you know, they still dealt with the same stuff, the same junk that they dealt with 20 years ago. And they're still dealing with that junk 20 years later. And most of the time, it's because they got one foot in the world and one foot in the church. And I'm just saying that if you really want to have victory, at some point you just got to say, I'm all in. That's what I had to do. You see, I wanted to live one way on Sunday because I liked church. I liked my church family. And I knew my parents would cut me off if I didn't go. So it was like, I like to eat. And so it was like, you know, we went to church all the time, but I wanted to do what I wanted to do on Friday night. And so I would do one thing on Friday night, but on Sunday morning I'd do what? And I liked both. Can I just be real? I liked both. Somebody said, if you don't enjoy sin, you're not doing it right. I mean, I enjoyed it, but there's a price tag with it, isn't there? You know, the book of Hebrews says that Moses enjoyed the pleasures of sin for a season. You know, he reaped some stuff. He sowed some things, but eventually he began to reap what he sowed. And he's like, this isn't as fun as it used to be. Can I just tell you, when I started walking in victory, it was when I got all in. I'm like, you know, guys, see ya. I had to say goodbye to some friends. I had to say goodbye to some habits, some hang-ups, some stuff, some hurts. I had to let that stuff go and say, I'm going to forget those things which are behind, and I'm going to move forward, and I'm going to walk with Jesus. I'm all in. And I can just tell you, the Christian life, the victorious life, only works when you're all in. Look at verse Nehemiah 2:18, again, it says, they set their hands to this good work. Can I just tell you something right now? This is going to be work. It's going to be work. If you want to rebuild, you want to walk in victory, it's going to be work. And I know it seems like our generation, they don't want to hear about work, especially in the church. Don't talk to me about works, Pastor. We're under grace. Yeah, no, I get it. I'm not talking about your salvation. In fact, look at Ephesians 2, verse 8. We all know this verse, or if you've been around at all, you know this verse. And it's important. We hang our salvation on this verse. For by grace you've been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the what? Gift of God. Everybody say it. Not of works, lest anyone should boast. How many of y'all believe that? That our salvation is by grace. In other words, it was a gift. God did it. We believed in Jesus. He gave us salvation. We did nothing. We couldn't work for it. We couldn't earn it. It was a gift. Thank you, Jesus. Now that we got that settled, let's read the rest of the scripture. because most of us don't go on. Now notice this, verse 10. For we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus. Notice these words. For good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. We're not saved by works, but once we're saved, he expects us to do some works. In fact, there's another verse that Paul gives in Philippians 2. Some of y'all heard this in church growing up, and you didn't even know there was another part to this verse. Look at this, Philippians 2, verse 12. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but how much more in my absence, notice these words, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. How many of y'all went to one of those churches growing up? You ever heard that verse? Anybody but me? You got to work out your salvation, brother. And in my head, I know he said work out, but in my mind, I heard work for. And I never felt like, I was like, you know, are you saved? Well, I'm trying, brother. We're trying. Are you a Christian? Trying to be. You know, it was always something in the future. I'm working for myself. That's not what it says. It says work it out. In other words, you have it. Now work it out. Right? But then look, he goes on. And notice what he says next. For it is God who works in you both to will and to do for his good pleasure. They never brought that up. Work out your salvation, brother. So I would leave and I'd try to work it out. Never told me. It's God who works in you. In other words, it's we set our minds that, you know what, I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. I'm not going to live that way anymore. God, I'm ready to change. I'm willing to do whatever it takes. But you're going to have to help me to give me the want to, but also to give me the ability to do it. And he says that he'll do it, and it's his pleasure to do it. Listen, notice this. The next thing you see is that the people had a mind to work. Nehemiah 4:6. So we built the wall. The entire wall was joined together up half its height, for the people had a mind to work. Write this down. You got to set your mind to it. You've got to make a decision that you're going to change. At some point, you just got to make that decision. You've just got to, it's, and the Bible calls it repentance. Repentance is a change of direction. You're going this way, and you go this way, but it starts with the change of mind. You're going this way, and you say, you know what? I'm not going to live this way anymore. Devil, I'm done. I'm not going to do it. I've changed my mind, and it leads in a change of direction. That's what repentance is. And listen, you've got to, and listen to me. If you want to change some things in your life, you're going to have to change some things in your life. If you always do what you've always done, you'll always get what you always got. Right? That's not the best English, but it's true. Right? I mean, it's... And the people, think about this. They were living in the land in the middle of promise. Here they are right there in the promised land, have all these promises from God, yet day after, the temple is built, but day after day after day, their lives are just being ravaged by the enemy. And the enemy was attacking them and winning, but when they made a decision and they said, enough is enough, that's when things started to change. Here's the next thing, and this is the last point. You have to deal with the rubble before you can rebuild. Nehemiah 4:10 says this, and Judah said, the strength of the laborers is failing. In other words, they started work, but notice these words, there's so much rubbish that we're not able to build the wall. In fact, if you can put up that picture, listen, imagine that this is what the wall looked like, and then there's all these, that's the work environment. And so they're trying to rebuild, but they keep tripping over the rocks. They keep tripping over stuff that's been there for 100 years. When I was a contractor, when I built homes and stuff, it used to drive me crazy, the subs that would work, and they would work, and just they just leave stuff wherever, and boards and sheetrock, and just, you know, they just walk, and, you know, they drop something, and it's just like, you know, it's a house, my goodness, and they would do something, and they'd take a drink and just, you know, and just keep going, and I'm like, and then next thing you know, the next guy just tripped over his bottle, and there's 2x4s and stuff, and I'm like, come on, guys, clean up your mess so we can work around here. And every day we would stop early to clean up because you got to deal with the rubble if you're going to move forward. And listen, and what this was is this represented stuff from their past that they hadn't dealt with. And can I just tell you, if you're going to rebuild, You gotta deal with the stuff from your past. You gotta declutter your life. You can't move forward with all that stuff that you don't need anymore. You know, it's true in the natural. It's also true in the spiritual. You know, listen, I am a recovering hoarder. Not like you see on TV, but like I wouldn't throw stuff away. But I'm married to someone who won't put up with that. If it wasn't for Becky, I don't know where I'd be. But my goodness, if something sits around too long, I mean, we'll set something on the counter, and if it's there for a couple days, it's gone. She'll put it somewhere. I'm like, where'd you put that? She said, the counter's not the... This isn't a storage area, Troy. She didn't talk to me like that. That's the way I hear it. You know what I'm saying? So, and some of y'all, listen, it's time to clean the garage. Time to clean the yard. You got stuff out there from 3 Christmases ago. Come on, listen to me. Time to clean the closet. If you hadn't worn it in 2 years, you need to get it out. What's this have to do about Jesus? It's got everything to do. I don't know what, but I mean, it's... Listen, if it's 2 sizes too big, don't keep it. That's a reminder of where you used to be. Do you plan on going back there? Well, you never know. No, listen, get rid of it. That'll be your motivation not to go back there. Can I get a better amen? All right. Come on. Got to clean your car. You got French fries in there from 2017. We fill up so much with so much stuff, then we go rent a storage building to store up more stuff that we don't even use. But listen, what's true in the natural, if we're going to move forward, we got to declutter some stuff. Think about Ephesians 4. I just want you to see this in all seriousness and spiritual. We need to deal with some stuff from the past that was part of our old life before we got saved, and we've brought it into the new life. And Paul is telling the church, listen, you need to let that stuff go. Look what he says in Ephesians 4. In fact, jump down to verse 20. He says, that isn't what you learned about Christ. Since you've heard about Jesus and have learned the truth that comes from him, verse 22, throw off your old sinful nature and your former way of life, which is corrupted by lust and deception. Instead, let the Spirit renew your thoughts and attitudes. Put on your new nature, created to be like God, truly righteous and holy. In other words, he says, you've got some rubble from your old life. That's not who you are anymore. If you're anyone who's in Christ is a new creation. Stop using the excuses of that's just who I am. My mama was like that. My daddy was like that. He says, quit it. God is your father now. So he says, you got to put some of this stuff off. And he starts to give a list. Y'all ready for a list? If the first one doesn't hit you, just hang on. There'll be one for you, I promise. It'll be a scripture for you. You can claim it. Listen, here's verse 25. Stop telling lies. Let us tell our neighbors the truth, for we are all part of the same body. And don't sin by letting anger control. Listen, before we go on to that one, stop telling lies. Now, you wouldn't think he's writing to Christians. How about that? He's writing to the church. That inspires me to know that Paul had people in his church that told lies. That's good to know, isn't it? His church wasn't perfect either. All the New Testament church, they had it going on. Yeah, they had liars in the church. And listen, just stop. I know I had a Christian brother. He loved Jesus. But he just, a Christian for years, but just, he'd tell a lie for no reason. I mean, it didn't even make any sense. I'm like, and sometimes you just knew it wasn't true. And he'd say that, and he's like, dude, why'd you even say that? And he's like, I don't know. You know, it's just, we got to stop telling lies. Listen, notice this. Don't sin by letting anger control you. Listen, if you've dealt with anger your whole life, it's time to get rid of that. And one way to do it, he says, don't let the sun go down while you're still angry. In other words, we all get angry, but listen, if a week later you're still talking about how that lady treated you at Walmart, listen, you need to get over it. You're not going to believe what she said. Listen, okay, you got mad. Get over it. When you go to bed that night, forgive her and let it go. We don't want to hear about it. Can I get a witness, everybody? We don't want to hear it. Well, Pastor Troy doesn't want to hear it. I guess I have to tell somebody else. No, nobody wants to hear it. Don't let anger control you. Notice what it says, for anger gives a foothold to the devil. Listen, if you have anger in your life that you haven't dealt with, that's from your past. I'm telling you, your wall is broken down. And that's an area that the enemy is just coming in. You don't even realize it, but he's coming, and he's coming into other areas of your life. And he's just having his way in your life because you have let that boundary come down, and you have let that anger allow the enemy to come in and just have his way with you. And Paul's saying, stop. The way to deal with it is just to every day forgive him and let it go. Notice this, verse 28. If you're a thief, quit stealing. He had some thieves in the church. Imagine that. You can imagine him having that conversation. Joe, I need to talk to you a minute. We've been noticing that the communion has been missing. You got to quit stealing the communion cups, man. I know you like to get a little bit into the wine a little bit, but I mean, we're going to need that next Sunday. We're going to need you to stop stealing. And I mean, imagine that going on in the church. And he's saying these things to him. And he says, listen, quit thieving. Instead, use your hands for good, hard work, and then give generously to others in need. In other words, quit mooching off everybody else and go get your own job. Take care of yourself. And then be generous with what you get. Look at verse 29. Don't use foul or abusive language. Some of y'all didn't know that was in the Bible. Can I just tell you that after I got saved, I had to get rid of some of my vocabulary? You know, can you imagine? Obviously, I couldn't be a pastor if I had kept some of the vocabulary I had when I was a teenager. And you gotta let that stuff go. In fact, he says, let everything you say be good and helpful so that your words will be an encouragement to those who hear them. Don't bring sorrow to God's Holy Spirit by the way you live. Remember, he has identified you as his own, guaranteeing that you will be saved on the day of redemption. In other words, you belong to the Lord now. Don't bring sorrow to God. He paid a great price for our salvation. Come on. When we don't live lives that glorify him, it's really approach to Christ. Becky, you can come on up. Notice what he said. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, harsh words, slander, as well as all types of evil behavior. Listen, that's rubble. That's the rubble in our lives that have come from our past. And he said, instead, begin to rebuild the boundaries by being kind to each other, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, just as God through Christ has forgiven you. For some of us, maybe the rubble is unforgiveness. And you have a hurt from your past, and you haven't forgiven that person. Maybe there's a person you haven't forgiven. Maybe some of you need to forgive God because God didn't respond the way that you thought he should, and you're kind of bitter toward God over something that happened, something that he allowed to happen. Or maybe you need to forgive yourself. You know, most of the time, the one we're most upset with is ourselves, but just as God has forgiven you need to forgive others. We need to forgive him, and we need to forgive ourselves. He goes on in chapter 5. I'm almost done, but he said, let there be no sexual immorality. That's any kind of sexual relationship outside of marriage. Any kind of sexual relationship outside of marriage, he says, listen, impurity, any of that stuff, don't even let there be a hint among you. That's what the pagans do. That's what the ungodly do. You're a child of God. He says, guys, you can't do that anymore. You gotta quit it. Don't do that. Don't let there be any greed among you. Always wanting more. Such sins have no place among God's people. Obscene stories and foolish talk and coarse jokes, these are not for you. Instead, let there be thankfulness to God. You can be sure that no immoral, impure, or greedy person will inherit the kingdom of Christ and of God. For a greedy person, always someone who's always wanting more, intense, selfish desire, is an idolater, worshiping the things of this world. You know, just greedy, just, I've got enough, but I just always want more. He said, that's idolatry, everybody. Listen, this morning, how many of us want to put away some things? I hope so. Some rubble from our past, some stuff that we've never dealt with. And you know, maybe it's something you've been stumbling over. You've been stumbling over that mess for too long, and you just want to say, this, that's who I was, is not who I am. I used to be in darkness, but now I'm in the light. And here's what I want to encourage you with. There's things that, you know, you've been battling with for a lifetime. Can I tell you this, that God can do a quick work? Nehemiah 6:15, I love this. So the wall was completed on the 25th of Elul in 52 days. What they had allowed to happen for 72 years, they fixed in 7.5 weeks. Can I just tell you that when we set our mind that enough is enough, and we cry out to God for health, and we take responsibility for our own life, and we say, no more excuses, I'm all in, I've made up my mind, listen, God can do a quick work. Look at what he goes on to say in Nehemiah 6. It says, when all our enemies heard about this, the surrounding nations were afraid and they lost their self-confidence because they realized this work had been done with the help of our God. Listen, the same enemies that had defeated them for 72 years and they had been afraid of them, now that the wall was rebuilt and they saw God's hand working in the midst of them, now their enemies were afraid of them because they saw that God's hand was upon them. Listen, the same enemy who's been having his way in your life for day after day and year after year, listen, when you begin to work and begin to say, you know what, enough is enough, God, help me to overcome these things, listen, the enemy will start fearing you instead of you living in fear of the enemy all these times. And faith will begin to arise in your life, and you're going to see mountains moved. It's time we stop living in fear and we walk by faith, so the enemy of our souls will walk in fear as we see our God at work. Amen. I want you to stand to your feet. I want you to see something. Show that last picture there. You know, I started out talking about 9/11. 9/11, when our world changed. And if you remember, the Twin Towers were there in New York City. And, you know, today stands the Freedom Tower, the One World Trade Center. Amazing thing. But before they could rebuild, they had to deal with the rubble. It took them 8.5 months just to get the rubble there at Ground Zero, where there was, when they got done, it was like a 16-acre pit, just this huge pit. Just day after day, they had to deal with the rubble. But listen, while they were dealing with the rubble, as they're cleaning out the rubble, they found, and this is a real picture, they found this cross standing there. And that's, listen, I just want to encourage you, when you set your mind and say, you know what, I'm going to rebuild, and you start to deal with the rubble in your life, when you start dealing with it and you take action, you're going to find that Jesus is right there with you. And it's not something you're going to have to do on your own. It's not just, I'm going to make up my mind and I'm going to try really hard to fix things. We've all done that. It doesn't work. But as you begin to deal with the rubble and cry out to Jesus, listen, he will be right there in the midst of your rubble, in the midst of your ashes. And as you rebuild, his hand will be upon you to do amazing things. Well, let's pray. Father God, we come to you now. Lord, I just pray. God, we all have stuff. We all have stuff from our past that needs to deal with. Lord, we're all in the midst of this worldwide pandemic, God. God, the battle's not over. The war against COVID-19 isn't over. God, we're still here. And people have a reason to worry, and to fear is real because the virus is real. But God, I pray in the midst of it that we start to rebuild. We start to rebuild the walls of faith in our life. God, we begin to deal with some rubble. Lord, for those who are watching online or that are here this morning that have had some habits for decades, even though they're saved, God, they still got some old habits that they need to get rid of, or some hang-ups. or some hurts that they need healing from. God, I pray that it starts today. And as we make up our mind that today, today's a new day. Jesus, I ask you to begin to come and rebuild in our lives. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Listen, we're going to worship. We're really going to go after God here. This will be the last song that we sing today. If you want to come and pray, you can. You want to pray from your seat. But come on, use this time. Cry out to God to help you. And let's begin to rebuild it. Amen. Amen. God bless you.
praise you, God. Just sit here in his presence just for another minute. God put this on my heart. He says that when you confess your sins to him, you are forgiven. But when you confess your sins to one another, you are healed. And there are some people in here today. Listen, the church has to be more transparent than ever. I have problems. Pastor Troy has problems. We're a community and we are here for you. So allow us to pray for you right now. If there's, before the walls go up, the walls need to be broke down. There are walls that have to be broke down. And if that's you today, just hands up. I'm not calling you forward, but if you want me to pray, for maybe it's a generational curse. Maybe there's things happening in your life that needs to be broken right here, right now. I see you. There's things in your life that need to be broken. Jesus, we come to you in your beautiful name, God. And Lord, every hand that's up right now, God, Holy Spirit, I ask that you fall on them, Lord. And God, I ask that you break generational curses right now in the name of Jesus, God. We bound them up. Fear, you are not allowed here. Satan, you are not allowed here. Lord, we thank you, God. We ask that faith will arise through us, God. Lord, we praise your holy name, God. I ask that each and every person here, Lord, will be filled with your spirit and that they can go out into this community, Lord, and be the hands and feet of Jesus, God. We give you all the glory and we give you all the honor in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. Praise you, Lord. Before you head out today, we have our giving boxes on the back wall. If you are new here today and you received a Connect card, please take that to the foyer. We have a gift waiting on you. And if you've decided to follow Jesus, please come forward. I want to help you with your next steps. God bless you all and have a great week.